Which one's the better buy? The $50 air cooler or the $50 AIO? It's a good question, and part of the reason why I wanted to make this video is because I noticed that Deepcool, at the time of preparing to film this one, was running a good sale on their Castle 120R. So this is a 120mm all-in-one liquid cooling solution for your CPU. It supports up to AM4 and I don't believe the latest Intel CPUs yet, although I'm sure it'd be very easy to add that support to a later revision of this. But it's very compact, it's very sleek, and still quite effective, and that's why these are great for mid-towers and ITX builds with CPUs that have mid to low TDPs. Now off to my left here is the Scythe Mugen 5, but more specifically, the black edition of the Mugen 5, which means that it looks freaking awesome. Check out this shot I took here. This is actually our test bed, our test rig, that we used for both of these coolers. And this thing just, it just blends in so nicely. I am such a sucker for black tower coolers. I like the Be Quiet ones. I like the Hyper 212 Black Edition. There are a few others that come to mind, but yeah, this one from Scythe is just, they really nailed it in the aesthetics department. But how a cooler looks is often not as important as how it performs. And that's why this video exists. I think you will enjoy it. I think you'll be surprised by the results as well. Stay with me. Ridge Wallet makes sleek, compact wallets good for up to 12 cards plus room for cash. Choose between over 30 designs including burnt titanium, brushed carbon, and this cool topography texture. I've been repping Ridge Wallets for several months now, and in my opinion, there's really no substitute for something this compact, portable, and efficient. Best of all, you'll enjoy durable materials and a lifetime warranty for peace of mind. No wonder they're backed by over 40,000 five-star reviews. So check them out via the link below or visit ridge.com/Salazar and use code Salazar, that's S-A-L-A-Z-A-R, to save 10%.
We're gonna jump right into the meat and potatoes of this one, starting first with a side-by-side comparison of specifications. Now remember that these coolers are totally different in terms of philosophy, how they get rid of heat, how they move it and relocate it from one area to another. Obviously the CPU is what's generating the heat and you need some sort of medium to move that heat away from the source. AIOs often use water or a glycol solution and tower coolers typically use either copper or nickel plated copper heat pipes. The Mugen 5 has 6 of these along with a fairly large aluminum fin stack, whereas the Castle 120R here, well, everything's a bit more compact. So you have closer spaced aluminum fins, but then again, you also have quite a bit of water to absorb a lot of that heat. Water has a very high heat capacity, so it takes a lot of energy to raise water by a single degree Celsius, assuming a fixed volume. The two variables we're looking to isolate here are sound and temperature, and we're going to use IDA64 to create a very sustained load, a very constant sustained load on the CPU. We'll also put a load, of course, on the FPU, which is a part of the CPU, depending on how you categorize that, the cache, the RAM, and the GPU. We'll also stress disks, just because why not? So this system for both scenarios will, for all intents and purposes, be under a full load. It's important to note that the graphics card really doesn't get super stressed in IDA64, but it will be generating some heat, and that could play into our results here. My train of thought here was that most folks who buy products like these are probably going to game at some point, right? They're building a custom PC, but what they do with it, I mean, it's of course subjective. Are you going to do things that only stress the CPU or only stress the graphics card? So I think it's important to stress both, at least somewhat, so that we get a fair representation under most scenarios where both will come into play. Gaming, for instance, is one of those where you're probably going to have a heavily stressed CPU and GPU with few exceptions.
Something else to add, both of these products include its own 120mm fan. And while it would be easy to just fan standardize, which means to use the same fan in both scenarios, I don't think that's a fair representation of the average builder with this kind of budget. If you're spending $50 on a cooler, specifically a 120mm AIO, I think this is as small as it gets for the most part. You can buy smaller than this, but they're very niche. You're probably not going to spend $30 or $40 extra for a super optimized, very quiet fan. So I'm going to use the ones that are included in the boxes. The Mugen 5, we'll be using the Scythe fan, and for the 120R, we'll be using the Deepcool fan. I'm not gonna take up too much time talking about our test bed here. You can find the specifications in the video description if you wanna buy anything that's included in this rig. We do have a Ryzen 5 2600 in here, a B550M motherboard from Asus. We have a 6600 XT from Gigabyte, and a 500-watt power supply from EVGA. The case is a Cooler Master Q300L. Airflow is subpar, if I do say so myself. It's not optimal, but because we're only using one fan in either instance, I think that it's still a level playing field.
So let's get into those numbers.
Let's start with temperature. I was sure to run each of these tests for an hour, and this really isn't as important for air coolers, which usually heat up and saturate themselves fully after I don't know, 10 or 20 minutes. But AIOs, it's important you let these run for at least 30 minutes, but I always go for an hour just because, especially for the larger AIOs, you're gonna want that water to reach a thermal equilibrium. Otherwise, you'll be seeing temperatures that don't really reflect what the true state of the CPU is long-term. So you can see in Ida 64, both CPU diode and package temperatures reach 76 degrees peak. So this is peak temperature here. It's as hot as it ever got for the entire 1 hour or so run. And if we juxtapose this with the air cooler run, you can see the temperatures were actually pretty much the same, about 77 degrees Celsius in the Mugen 5's case. So for all intents and purposes, I mean, a 1 degree Celsius delta within the margin of error, I would say. One other thing to note, while again, temperatures were more or less the same, I noticed the CPU clock speed in the Mugen 5's case was slightly lower than that of the Castle 120R. So after an hour had passed under full load, the CPU was throttling frequency back to 3650 megahertz or so in the Mugen 5's case. Whereas in the 120R's case, frequency is about 50 megahertz higher. Now this isn't something you're likely to notice in real world usage, but it is a slight advantage toward the AIO. And again, this is with the exact same fan curve for both scenarios. Now, remember that each of these fans is different, and that's just a consequence of whichever cooler you decide to go with, though they are both 120 millimeter fans and PWM controlled, they do both have different operating RPMs. So as CPU temperature increases, we would expect that our normal fan curve will kick in and try to make up for that excess heat being dumped into whatever cooler is at play. And that is why it's also important to measure sound, or in this case, apparent loudness with our sound meter. It doesn't really make sense to call the AIO the winner if, while it is slightly cooler, it runs louder. So of course, right, there's that trade-off there that you have to keep in mind. And that's why, again, we whipped out the sound meter and measured both of these coolers after an hour-long burn-in each. That goes without saying, of course, all of these tests were run with the left side panel installed, including this audio test here. And would you look at that, the Mugen 5, yes, was slightly hotter, but it was also slightly louder. And this was something I could distinguish myself. I could tell very clearly that the tower was louder. It also had a higher pitch than the Deepcool fan did. Another thing I wanted to look at was operating RPM. So the Scythe Mugen 5 fan was actually operating at around 1200 RPM, and the Deepcool fan was operating at around the same. So this comes down to just fan design and where the fan is located in this case as well, because you have to remember that the Scythe fan is located right in front of a tower, more or less in the middle of the chassis, and the Deepcool fan is located more toward the backside of the case, where you would expect natural exhaust fans to be placed. Now, obviously, this isn't representative of all tower coolers out there, and that's not what this video is seeking to do. There are many tower coolers I could name that are quieter than even 240 millimeter AIOs under the same load. So keep in mind that this is a very product-specific test we're running here. And again, I felt like it would be fun to mash these two up because they were the same price when I decided to make this video. So with this data in mind, the Castle 120R at $50 is a better buy than a $50 Mugen 5 Black Edition. That's not really what I expected, and the AIO operated quieter and it kept temperatures lower. This only being a 120 mil radiator here, I figured that because it was smaller, more compact, it wouldn't be able to withstand as much heat and it would result in higher package temperatures, but the opposite was actually the case. Which again, is not what I expected. I went into this thinking that because the Scythe Mugen 5 had the larger heat sink by apparent size, and we're not talking fin density, it was just a larger heat sink in general, I assumed that it would be the better cooler and that it would run quieter as well. But the opposite is true. So let's try one more thing, because why not? I'm curious. If we swap fans, that is, if I put the Castle 120R's fan over the tower of the Mugen 5, will that make up for the delta? If it does, and that suggests that the Scythe fan is just not as good for these kinds of scenarios, and maybe even this kind of case. But if it doesn't solve the issue, then it's likely that the Scythe Mugen 5's heatsink is just not prepared enough to handle the thermal load of a 2600 as well as the 120Rs. I would be fairly surprised if that was the case because, again, this radiator is just so small and so compact, but maybe fin density is playing a bigger role than we thought in this case. So let's remove this fan. Should be fairly straightforward. Disconnect it up top here. And just kind of sort of slide it on out. There we go. And we'll recycle the mounting clips for our Deepcool fan here. So just snap into place. There we go. And one more down here. Reconnect it to the same fan header. Make sure that these cables don't get snagged while we're running these tests.
and we'll be on our way.
So with everything else exactly the same, save again that fan swap, package and diode temperatures reach 76 degrees Celsius, which is identical to the temperatures we got with the Castle 120R. All of these temperatures are within 1 degree Celsius of each other, so we could chalk most of this up again to the margin of error. But the Deepcool fan does seem to be slightly more effective at moving air. That said, if we look at our sound test, the sound profile of this cooler with the Deepcool fan is pretty much the same as it was with the Scythe fan. So not much of an audible difference here. Both were quite loud by comparison. Using the Deepcool fan with the Deepcool AIO was actually the quietest of the three scenarios. I want to stress again that this is a very product-specific test. My goal here is not to show that liquid cooling is better than air cooling or vice versa. Personally, I've done a lot of both, and while I do see some benefit using AIOs, especially larger AIOs or larger radiators in those all-in-one liquid coolers, in the long run, they still have an extra failure point, that being the pump. There's a potential for leaks as well, and that could damage other components, whereas in the case of most air towers, you just gotta worry about a fan dying. And if that happens, well, for one, it's gonna be pretty obvious, and for two, it's not really gonna take much else with it, save possibly your CPU if for whatever reason it doesn't thermal throttle and shut itself down to save itself. Now, if I personally had to choose between these two, I'd say it's very build dependent. For a build like this, in the Cooler Master Q300L, I'd choose the 120mm AIO. I think it's a bit sleeker, it looks nice in here, and of course we have the space for it. But you also have to take into account the fact that this can leak, the pump can die, and that can be problematic in the long run. The failure rates of these are quite low because the only moving component is the fan. The other side of this is that for $50, I mean, this is one of the cheapest AIOs you can buy for 50 bucks. That is a win in Deepcool's case, I think. That's the competitive advantage that it has. Apart from some of the other smaller technological feats, if you want to call them those, the anti-leak tech is actually pretty cool. A little bladder in there expands when the fluid gets too hot, because the fluid in here does slightly expand when it reaches a thermal equilibrium. So that stuff's in here and that's cool and all, but I think the real selling point here is the price. It's one of the cheapest AIOs you can buy. Whereas in the Mugen 5's case, it gets a bit more dicey. I personally think that a $50 price tag for this is a bit of a... It's kind of a letdown. If you're gonna spend 50 bucks on an air cooler, you could probably justify spending a tad bit more than that. And if you can justify spending a tad bit more than that, you're probably looking at Noctua or Be Quiet or some other very premium, very quiet air cooler brand, I should say. And they make plenty of good stuff in the $60 to $80 range. This venture is awfully close to that price territory. You also have to consider that there are cheaper counterparts to this that perform almost as well. In my testing, the Cooler Master Hyper 212 Black Edition performs about 90 to 95% as good as this. And that's another thing you have to consider, is that you have cheaper options that perform nearly as good. They might not be as quiet because, again, smaller heat sinks, the fans have to work a bit harder. I think what Scythe's done here, they've made a really good product. It's just a tad bit expensive at 50 bucks. You're venturing into, again, that higher end air cooler territory, and you're also venturing into AIO territory. And even a 120mm AIO can keep up and even outperform slightly an air cooler like this. So that's where I have to leave it. I didn't expect to conclude it this way. I thought that the Castle 120R would fall a bit short, frankly, but that wasn't the case. And I have to follow the data. Our data suggests that the 120mm AIO is the better buy. Well, that was a lot of fun. Like, we don't run a lot of these tests anymore just because there's so many channels are doing the same thing nowadays, and at this point I just defer to them. It's too much to keep up with, and we don't have an entire team that can run all these benchmarks. I have to do everything myself here, so I'm just already kind of on the back foot in that department. That said, whenever I see a decent deal and I think it's worth juxtaposing two products that are, again, essentially the same price, I think it can make for a fun video. We can kind of experiment a bit and see what's what, what's causing things to behave the way that they are, and yeah, hopefully you enjoyed this one as much as I did. If you did, be sure to give this one a thumbs up. I would appreciate that. Consider subscribing if you have not already, and stay tuned for more of the good stuff here on the channel. My name is Greg. Thanks for learning with me.